Alright, hello everybody and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. At the beginning of these episodes, where there used to be disclaimers, are now put at the top of the description in each episode, so that if you are new here or are returning after a while, I do ask that you go read those, because they might help clear up the discussion for the style of these videos that I do. But, without further ado, we're talking today about Nekomonogatari Black, which is it's an arc, but it's a standalone series at the same time. So it's a little weird how they did that, but they did it that way, so that's how we're covering it. We're talking about this, of course, after previously talking about Nisei Monogatari. However, this is a prequel to something or other, so this does not chronologically come right after what I just watched or what I had just talked about. And just like with the Nisei Monogatari video, keep in mind that now, as of the recording of this video, which is currently on the 30th of July, today, I finished watching the second season, Monogatari series second season. So I have now completed that, and that will be the next episode we'll talk about, which is what I'm mainly looking forward to doing, is talking about that show, since I have a lot of stuff to talk about. But here with Nekomonogatari, let's get over some of the basic stuff. So it aired on television. From what I was told, though, all episodes aired back to back as like one thing, but there's four episodes in it, which they kind of said that didn't make much sense. And I kind of agree. If you're going to air it on television, it's a television show. But if you air all four episodes back to back, why is it a four episode thing? Shouldn't it just be a movie or, you know, something along those lines? It just doesn't, I don't see the point in doing it that way. But I don't know. I'm not Shaft. I'm not Aniplex or whoever the hell decided to post this where they wanted to do it. Each episode is about 26 minutes. When you cut out the ending stuff, really you're looking at just under 2 hours for total watch time. And it was released in 2012. It is, of course, run by or created by the studio Shaft. Of course, and the producers here are Aniplex of America, Hiss Hiss, and Kodansha. I'm not exactly sure what the pronunciation on that is. It is listed as a drama, mystery, psychological, supernatural, romance. And most of that stuff kind of works. Mystery still a little watery, psychological works, supernatural works, drama works, and romance works. At least in this little four episode thing. So this episode's probably going to be a little bit on the shorter end because it is only a four episode thing we're talking about. And the specific arc that this show focuses on is Tsubasa Family. So it is a Hanekawa focused arc, which is good because Hanekawa was one of like the only characters that I kind of liked up to this point in watching. And I mentioned a few things about this particular series in my Nisei Monogatari video. I do recommend that if you have watched, or excuse me, if you have not watched my Bakke Monogatari or Nisei Monogatari thoughts and opinions videos, they'll be linked in the description down below. It'd be best to watch those in the chronological order that I uploaded them so that you have a good idea of what my opinions of the series of Monogatari is as we go along, so you can see how things either get better, get worse, stay the same, whatever it might be. So Nekomonogatari, well, in my opinion, it's kind of like Nisei Monogatari. It's kind of like to me, it's an extension sort of feeling in terms of overall tone of the show. It's very comedic at the beginning. It's got a lot of ecchi in it, and it's also really short since it's only four episodes for the whole package for just the one arc. Like I said, since they separated it. But there are some genuinely good scenes in here that I actually really, really was entertained by, which we'll talk about. But I gotta get one thing out of the way first. We gotta talk about the boobs. Okay. Hello? We've gotta talk about the boobs. So I mentioned the boobs in the Nisei Monogatari video. Well, in this, at the very beginning, you're gonna see his sister, Koyomi's sister's boobs, right? I mean, she just straight up takes her shirt off right there in the place. Right in front of him in the same room, and they're totally okay with them being brother and sister, and she just takes her shirt off like it's nothing. They don't even do, like, Koyomi doesn't even do anything with it, like, he doesn't do anything ecchi with it or anything. It's just, like, it's a totally normal thing to do. So if they roll that way, that's fine. But on multiple occasions with not only his sister, but also, I think on another character, I don't remember if it's Hanekawa. I think it's Hanekawa when you see her in her, like, lingerie. The boobs jiggle, okay? Now, listen, right? This sounds silly what I'm talking about, but I'm genuinely talking about the boob jiggle here for a minute, okay? No silliness here. Their boobs jiggle, okay? That was not in Bakke or Nisei really at all. There was none of that really detailed boob jiggling. I mean, it's like 60 FPS type boob jiggle. That's how smooth it is when you see it. And to be honest, I've never seen an anime, with or without ecchi, where there is side boob jiggle. I've never seen one before like that. I mean, sure, there might be a scene where literally the ecchi of the scene is the fact that they're touching the boobs or they're squeezing it, or, you know, one of the girls is standing behind the character and is, like, squeezing the breasts. Whatever, you know. It's nothing like that where they've clearly put detail because that's the focus of the scene. No, this is, like, some background shit. And they're walking, she walks to the side, or she just turns to look and her boobs... You know, I don't know. It just caught my eye so damn much because it was so... smooth looking to me, and I hadn't seen it before, which, yes, in turn means that Nekomonogatari is directly responsible for me going to the internet to learn exactly what boobs are made of. Okay, I knew what a boob was, of course I know what a boob is, but I didn't know what boobs exactly are made of, you know, fleshy tissue, fatty tissue, okay, what specifically is in the boob that makes it very, very squishy and jiggly? Well, that's what I went to learn. Yes, Nekomonogatari Black is directly responsible for my educational venture into what boobs are made of. I digress, moving on, that was that. I just thought I needed to mention that. One of the very entertaining scenes for me personally was right at the beginning when Karen comes in after a jog. It's like hot outside, you know, and she's sweating. But it's really funny. It's literally the type of thing you would see in a parody show. And this is the type of parody I can laugh at, where she comes in, the door's there, you know, you got the little entrance area where you take your shoes off and stuff and put them up in the drawers or whatever the hell you'd call those things, the shoe shelf. And she's sweating because she went on a jog, but she's literally sweating like a river. And I mean, the floor is getting filled up with water. She takes her shoe off and flips it upside down and it just splatters. Water just starts pouring out like an ocean. You know, it was really, really funny. And they don't even really like focus on it for a punchline. It's just there. It's like, it's just part of the world, which means it really fit in with the rest of the scene, and I thought it was really funny the way that they did that. And because it's totally relatable, when you go out for a jog, especially in the middle of summer or when it's hot out or something, this I think is in spring, right? I could be wrong. I don't know when this takes place. Spring or early summer, I think, is when this particular arc takes place. You feel like you've literally lost every drop of water that has been in your body from it. So yeah, moving on. So this... whole arc focuses on, I think this is the one that focuses on Hanekawa and the Sawari Neko, which is, again, it's something that the show explains very straightforward, but then the character kind of intertwines it, and it's not as straightforward as the explanation isn't as straightforward as they first tell you. Like, supposedly the Sawari Neko feeds off of people's sympathy. Like, for example, it'll pretend to be dead on the side of a street, and then we'll feed off people's sympathy to go and pick it up. And Hanekawa, I guess, apparently went to pick it up, and she was lying to herself. She wasn't really sympathizing with it, and thus she was cursed and possessed by the Sawari Neko, or something along those lines. I think, question mark, I'm still not 100% sure on if that's exactly how she turns into said cat. And then she basically has this alter ego. She has two different personalities. There's Hanekawa, and then there's Nekokawa. And at night, this Neko will come out. Basically, she'll turn into a cat girl, to be blunt about it. And it's a completely different personality. The cat person is basically its own type of being. It refers to Hanekawa as her master, etc. And she only comes out, the cat version only comes out, if... Hanekawa is stressed. Basically, that's how she relieves stress, is by turning into this cat person, going out at night and causing a ruckus, or rising ruckus, you know. I think that's pretty much the general idea of what's going on behind it, right? In Bakemonogatari, we had a little bit of that, and I think it was in Bakemonogatari where the stress was revealed to be that Hanekawa loves Koyomi, and that was creating stress because, well, romance is a really shitty but beautiful thing at the same time. Here it's... Did I write it down in my notes, really, what was causing it? It seems to be more of like a family issue. Of course, she gets hit by her father, which I thought we saw in... I feel like we saw some of these scenes in Bakke Monogatari too. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like some of the scenes, like when she picks up the cat, or when she had gotten beat or hit, that was from Bakke Monogatari. I feel like they were the exact same scenes, but like I said, I could be wrong on that. Anyways, she has a bandage on her face, and Koyomi wants to know about it, and it turns out, of course, that she was hit by her father, and she just totally plays it off like, you know, she's to blame, and it's totally okay that he was doing that, you know, who could put up with a girl of my type at this age who thinks she knows everything, etc., that kind of garbage talking. She really needed to have her nipples poked, that was for sure, for saying shit like that. Koyomi licks her wound, you know, as you do. Which at first I was like, what the fuck? But I guess that's just what you can do to heal the wound. That's got to be pretty awkward to let somebody lick your wound face or your face wound. I'm just reading through my notes here quick just to get a thing here. Oh, right. One of the other things that made me a little bit confused about the whole Hanekawa and Cat Kawa situation was the fact that there's points where the cat girl just suddenly is Hanekawa, and she's talking and looks like her and everything just with cat ears, and like the fact that she's been in control the whole time, she's just been putting on the facade that she's not actually in control. That is what really threw me off, because I wasn't sure if that was really the case or not, but you see that in two scenes in these four episodes. If anybody can clear something up with that there, if I missed something, I don't know, but that threw me off specifically in one of the later scenes here. But essentially, things are kind of going really wrong, as they do, because he can't have a happy ending, and so Koyomi has to figure out how to solve this issue, otherwise somebody could die, or multiple people could die. She has no issue with killing people. And ultimately, Koyomi kind of sacrifices himself to save Hanekawa, which I thought was kind of a noble thing to do. He does it in a really weird fucking way. Without going into too much detail, he kind of does it by... Koyomi utilizes a sword that gets introduced. It's this ridiculously long, spiritual-type weapon that can damage... What are they called? I don't know if you refer to them as apparitions or whatever you refer to the supernatural elements of this show. And he basically hides the sword in his body, I guess by swallowing it. I don't really know how else he would have gotten it in his body. He hides it down one leg, which must have been really painful to do. And so he kind of talks the Nekokawa into attacking him. And once she does that, which results in cutting him in half, you know, because as you do, she gets damaged by the sword because she cut a guy that has a massive sword inside him in half, and the sword didn't cut her in half, but it still was able to damage the supernatural element of the situation. And, well, the whole scene kind of plays out, and Koyomi's laying there with his guts hanging out, you know, he's totally, half of his body's just sitting up there against the wall, and he's totally calm about it, you know, he's really good, but he knows he's gonna die, and everything's fine, and you know, he's okay with it. He accepts it because Hanekawa is back to normal and he saved her. And, you know, it's kind of a heartwarming scene to see that. And they're talking to each other a little bit. Hanekawa's like, why the fuck did you do this? You know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it ends. And, of course, Koyomi survives. He didn't actually die there. Hanekawa gets back. She still has the Sawari Neko, but... It's more under control, I think. It comes back later, of course, and that later would be Bakke Monogatari when we see it there, I think. That is when it comes back, right? This is a prequel to Bakke Monogatari, I think. I could be wrong on that. But yeah, whatever. It's a good ending. It's a happy ending. It's a nice ending. But it is frustrating because Koyomi doesn't like Hanekawa. Okay, but this is what's frustrating about it. It's not indirectly like a case where, you know, it's not like ReZero where there's a particular two female characters and the male character likes one of the female characters and then rejects another one. This is a little different because Hanekawa likes Koyomi, right? Hitagi likes Koyomi, right? And we, specifically with season two, I can kind of believe that situation now, because honestly, up to the end of season two, I really couldn't buy the fact that Hitagi actually likes Koyomi, because she never really shows any fucking emotion. Well, she shows emotion in that show, finally, so I'll talk more about that detail in detail there, in that discussion. But Koyomi has openly said more than once that he loved and loves Hanekawa. She's the perfect girl. She is all this different stuff. Yet, for no logical reason, he just settles for Hitagi instead. Like, he doesn't give an actual reason as to why he can't go with Hanekawa, in a sense. He'll continuously say how much he loves her and how she really likes her and how she's perfect. He even licks her desk, mind you, in school. But he doesn't actually give any logical reasons as to why he's not going with this. Like, it's not like ReZero, where Subaru specifically loves one character and that's it. That's logical, right? This, I can't see a logical reason as to why Hanekawa isn't good enough, and why Hitagi was just... I don't know, because honestly, up to season two, I just don't see anything between Hitagi and Koyomi. Nothing. Oh, the only thing I've seen now, by the end of season two, is Hitagi actually gives a shit. But I still haven't even seen shit from Koyomi. Koyomi goes as far to say, I have no idea why I'm even dating you, to Hitagi. You don't just say that to your girlfriend. You just don't say that to anybody like that. And I don't remember specifically, I'm going to say it here just in case, but I don't remember specifically if it's in Nekomonogatari or if it's in Tsubasa Tiger at the beginning of series two, or whatever, series second season. I'll mention it again there just in case. But there's a scene where Koyomi specifically says, basically, in a matter of one sentence, that I love you but don't love you, sort of thing. And it just doesn't make any sense to me. That's frustrating from Koyomi's perspective, for my perspective towards Koyomi. And that's hard enough already when I just don't like Koyomi to begin with. He's not a very likable character, in my opinion. He's not done anything that's likable up to this point. Yeah, he saved Hanekawa and helped her out of a shitty situation and nobly tried sacrificing himself, but that's not good enough to redeem him, in my opinion. But yeah, that's just my stance on the whole thing there. I definitely prefer Hanekawa over most of the other characters up to this point in the discussion, not including series second season. And I hope that we can see more Hanekawa in the future, at least in some side scenes. Of course, we have another arc for Hanekawa to talk about in greater detail with the series second season discussion. Because I even wrote in my notes, why won't he just be hers? I can't see an actual reason as to why that's not a possibility. The only other things I wrote in here are just other little scenes, like how he's sleeping with his sister, as Koyomi is at one point, which is kind of a funny little scene. It's also really adorable. And that's kind of it. That's really the whole gist of my stance on this. Watched it on the 24th of July, so about 6 days ago. So we watched series second season over the course of about 6 days. Finished it today, like I said. And yeah, it was fine. It was okay. Like I said, it kind of felt like Nisei Monogatari, like an extension, simply and purely because it had a lot of ecchi and the boob jiggle stuff in it. And of course, Hanekawa is always, whenever it's Nekokawa, it's always in lingerie. So, and every single time she's in lingerie, it's a different type, and it's really fancy and really seductive type of lingerie. So it's there, and they make use of those scenes. They make use of the fact she's not wearing many clothes at times. But all in all, it was okay at best. Now, seeing that it's a television, I would have originally thought that this would be like a special or an OVA, but no, it's a television, so it had to be rated by television standards on my analyst. I put it basically with Nisei Monogatari, but slightly higher, because I enjoyed the confrontation in this a little bit more, and it was focused on Hanekawa, who is a character I like a lot more than most other characters, so it was a little bit more enjoyable. I think at first it was when I had Nisei Monogatari at like 7.2 or whatever. Nekomonogatari was at like a 7.4. It's kind of, again, shifting between a 7.4, 7.3. There's a lot less here that I dislike than there was in Nisei Monogatari. But again, it's also a very short show, so there's not enough meat there for me to kind of... That's why I said it has to be I'm judging it via my television standards, and when there's only four episodes for a television show, there's a lot of extra things there that it kind of falls behind on. But yeah, that's going to bring my Nekomonogatari Black discussion to an end. If you have seen Nekomonogatari Black or any of the Monogatari stuff we've talked about so far, feel free to post your own opinions about it in the description or that's access to me, in the comment section down below. Feel free to post those, like it, dislike it, for what reasons. And in the next discussion video, we will be talking about Monogatari Series 2nd Season, which will be a pretty lengthy discussion video, most likely, because I have a lot of stuff to talk about there, and I have a lot of really good things to talk about, too. Like I said in my Nisei Monogatari video, all in all, so far, Monogatari has not been that fancy for me. It's not been living up to my expectations, or it hadn't been, it had outstayed its welcome with certain things, like the ecchi and stuff, but Monogatari Series 2nd Season is like, that right there is the first piece of Monogatari content that I can rightfully say, yeah, holy shit, we got a lot of good stuff to talk about. So, when we get there, we'll get there. Either sometime tonight or tomorrow, I'll probably get around to doing that video. But it'll be a lengthy one, so you'll have to stick around and just bear with it for a little bit if it takes a minute to get out. Anywho, that's going to bring this one to an end, so thanks for watching. Feel free to post your suggestions for other anime you'd like me to watch in the comment section down below. If it is an anime that is currently releasing, I will most likely not cover it until it is fully released. If it is an anime that is ongoing and has no end point in sight, I will not cover it as of yet. And if it is just about any other anime, I'll watch it as long as it is of the Eastern form and is trackable on Analyst specifically. Manga, however, is a different story. Go ahead and suggest whatever manga you want to me. Doesn't matter if it's finished, unfinished, or currently releasing. I will cover it because I cover those by a volume basis.